home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. There's always room for more. When I count my blessings, it's easy to see my brothers and sisters that mean so much to me. Think about the many times they've kept me in their prayers, and the countless ways they've always shown me that they care. And I know they'll still walk with me no matter what's ahead. Yeah, so much more than just their words, their lives have always said. Welcome to the family, you can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family, you can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. There's always room for more.
Share all your troubles like no other can do. He'll come down from the skies, brush the tears from your eyes. You're his child, and he cares for you. Someone to care, someone to share all your troubles like no other can do. He'll come down from the sky, brush the tears from your eyes. You're his child, and he cares for you. His power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter?
To a rugged tree, thinking he would never build again. There they held him through his hands and feet. Still he carried out a master plan. Jesus built a bridge to heaven so that I could have a way up to him. Jesus built a bridge, the only way he could, with only three nails and two pieces of wood. With one rugged cross, Jesus built a bridge. The Father looked from heaven to the world below and saw there was no way to claim his own. So to the world his Son, the Master Builder, had to go. To make a way to bring God's children home. Jesus built a bridge to heaven so that I could have a way up to him. Jesus built a bridge, the only way he could, with only three nails and two pieces of wood, with one rugged cross, Jesus built a bridge. With only three nails and two pieces of wood, with one rugged cross, Jesus built a bridge.
Bibles this morning, please, to Deuteronomy chapter 8. We spoke last week on America's foundation. Aren't you glad you live in a country that was built upon the foundation of Christianity and the Word of God? That's what has made America great, and we tried to cover that last week, and how Christianity and our political system was intertwined. There wasn't any question about it. I mean, it was even our politicians who were making great statements with regard to the Word of God. And while you're turning there, let me just share a few more statements. George Washington said it's impossible to rightly govern the world without God and the Bible. I wish we had presidents say that today. Who really was a Christian, really would stand for the Word of God. Andrew Jackson said, "That book, sir," speaking of the Bible, "is the rock on which our republic rests." And it was true. That's why we were built upon the Word of God. Abraham Lincoln said, "I believe the Bible is the best gift God has ever given to man. All the good from the Savior of the world is communicated to us through this book." Man, I'd give anything to hear our politicians say something like that today. Herbert Hoover even said this: The whole of the inspirations of our civilization springs from the teachings of Christ and the lessons of the prophets. To read the Bible for these fundamentals is a necessity of American life. And over again, the politicians of that day openly espoused the Word of God, Christianity, identified with it. And I also shared last week that many of the colonies required a person to be a Christian to hold office. You know, if that was true today, you'd wipe out the Congress, the White House. There'd be very few. You'd go in there and find, you're looking for the true Christian. I mean, you talk about vacancy. They couldn't stand the test today. Oh, they can get up and say, "I'm a Christian," but that means nothing. It means nothing. We're talking about people who really loved God, honored the Scriptures, and tried to build America the right way upon the Word of God. I mean, they believed the Ten Commandments. Now today, your politicians are trying to get the Ten Commandments out of the schools and the courthouses and places like that. You had to fight a battle just to keep the Ten Commandments in there. What in the world's wrong with the Ten Commandments? Thou shalt not kill. Something wrong with that? Thou shalt not steal. Something wrong with that? And so we were built right. But I want to move now from America's foundation to America's forgetfulness. And in Deuteronomy chapter 8, and we will start reading in verse 7 in just a moment, we're going to look at Israel's history and compare it to America's history. Heavenly Father, I pray you'll bless us today as we look at your word. And God, allow you to communicate a truth to us. Israel is an example to the world, and we're to learn by that example. And God, help us to learn our lesson and realize that God means what he says in the Bible. And God, the greatest mistake America can make is that one day we embraced the Word of God, we built our republic on the Word of God, and then make that grave mistake of forgetting the very God on which we built our republic. God, don't let that happen to us. Bless us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Israel and the United States have much in common spiritually. Now, God wrote this to Israel. And we can, again, learn by her example. You see, I really believe God, Israel and the United States, the greatest countries that have ever existed in the history of the world. Now, I know there were the Greeks, and I know that there were the Assyrians and the Romans, the Babylonians. But for the most part, those were lost people building empires. They had great strengths, ran by tough rulers, dictators, families, czars and Caesars and so on. But there's two distinct empires in history, and it's Israel and it's America. And those two countries were based and built and brought into existence by God for a godly purpose. When you start looking at Israel, God chose Israel to be a special people to himself. You go back to Genesis chapter 12 when God called Abraham and he says, I'm going to call you to be the father of the Hebrew, the Jewish nation. I'm going to raise up a people. And he did do that. Matter of fact, when you go to Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, he even tells Abraham, and oh, by the way, Abraham, those people who will bless you, I will bless. But those people who curse you, I will curse. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, I believe. And so God raised up the Jewish people. Why did he do that? He wanted to reveal himself to the world through a people. And so God raised up prophets to Israel. And God spoke through the prophet who addressed the people and told the people to live a certain way. Why? So that the world can see God through a people. And so they sometimes followed God. Many times they didn't follow God. And when they didn't follow God, God chastised Israel. And the world could actually even see God chastising his people. And so in a way, the world could see God at work through a people. And I believe that he raised up America for a people to the Gentiles, just as God raised up the Jewish people for a people to show himself, and actually for his own self as well. And so God chose America to be a people who would love and worship him. God chose the Jews through which he would bring forth the Messiah. God chose America to evangelize the world and tell the world that Jesus is the Messiah. And America faithfully did that, still doing it. And so even though the Jews do not believe in Jesus Christ, that's one of the reasons why God brought America into being. Once the Jews rejected Jesus Christ as the Messiah, later on he brought into existence America, who did believe that Jesus is the Messiah and the Savior of the world, and then blessed America in such a proportion and challenged us through the Word of God to go out and all the world preach the gospel to every creature. That's what our missionaries do. And so he raised us up for a purpose. And for these hundreds of years, we've been evangelizing the world, telling them about Jesus Christ, which the Jews failed to do. But nevertheless, God has a purpose for the Jewish people. Now, one of these days, the Jews will believe that Jesus is the Messiah. The last 7 years, during the tribulation period, God once again begins to deal with the Jews. That's why, America, you're toast if you turn your back upon God. God's going to once again begin to work with the Jews. And why is he going to do that? He's going to bring them to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ when Jesus returns. God blessed Israel in Solomon's day. He made it the greatest nation on earth. People from all over the world, kings and world leaders would come to sit at Solomon's feet and listen to his wisdom and look at his riches and his wealth and the abundance that God blessed Israel with. The same is true with America. God has made this American an exceptional country. People will do anything to get to America. They will risk their lives to get to America and to enjoy the bounty and the abundance and the affluence that is in America and that was made possible by God Almighty. God blessed us in making us the greatest nation on earth. Israel and America are strong allies. Israel and America put their faith in the same God. I don't even think it's coincidence that the three middle letters of Jerusalem is USA. What's the chances of that? Now, Jerusalem was called Jerusalem thousands of years ago, and then the United States comes along, and USA just happens to be the three middle letters of Jerusalem. I find that to be fascinating. I believe that there is a significance and there is a tie between America and Israel. Amen. I think we have a godly purpose, both of them, Israel as well as America. Amen. And so Israel again turned her back upon Jesus Christ. And then when Israel did that, God destroyed Jerusalem, 70 AD. They've not had a temple since 70 AD. Why? Because they rejected the Messiah. Amen. And God says, if you do this, it will destroy you. And yet they said, crucify him, to their own detriment. And God brought an invading power in, of course, we know, and Israel and Jerusalem was destroyed. The lesson to be learned is, America, if you turn your back upon God and Jesus Christ, so God will destroy and scatter America as well. Now, we get this right out of the book of Deuteronomy chapter 8. And let's look at it. I've broken this down into three or four points. Allow me, please. So let's look at the progression of a nation forgetting God. What can we learn from how God dealt with Israel? Number one, it was Jehovah God who was the source of Israel's prosperity, and it is Jehovah God who is the source of America's prosperity. Notice in verse 7, for the Lord thy God, speaking to Israel, for the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land. Now, how did they get into the good land? God brought them there. It wasn't by accident that they got into this good land. God says, I personally brought you there, Israel. A land of brooks of water, of fountains, and depths that spring out of the valleys and hills. A land of wheat and barley and vines and figs and pomegranates. A land of olive oil and honey. A land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness. Thou shalt not lack anything in it. A land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. And when thou hast eaten and are full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he hath given thee. Now notice, it was all made possible because of God Almighty. And I find it interesting when you read about the pilgrims on the Mayflower, in the Mayflower Combat Pact, when that group of pilgrims came to this land, signed on board of the Mayflower on November the 11th, 1620, is what they said, and this is what they signed. In the name of God, amen. It starts right off that way. We whose names are underwritten, the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign Lord King James, by the grace of God, of Great Britain, France, Ireland, King, Defender of the Faith, having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith. I mean, that was their purpose, to establish a Christian country that was free to worship the Lord in Jesus Christ. God brought them here. God literally gave them this land. And Anna went ahead and said, "In the honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern part of Virginia by these presents, solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and of one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body," and so on. But I'm saying to you, the underlying direction was God Almighty, the Christian faith, and God was directing it all the time as they submitted to God Himself. God was raising up a free people who wanted the freedom to worship the Christian faith. And I find that it's interesting, 300 years later, by 1920, America was fast becoming the most powerful country in the world. How could that happen from such a humble beginning? How could that happen? How could a handful of people come to this country out in the middle of the ocean and within 300 years be the most powerful country in the world? The hand of God. God was directing. President James Madison said this: "We have staked the whole future of American civilization not upon the power of government, far from it. We have staked the future of all of our political institutions upon the capacity of mankind for self-government, upon the capacity of each and all of us to govern ourselves, to sustain ourselves according to the Ten Commandments of God." And so, God was directing, just as God says, "Israel, I have brought you into this land. I'm going to give you everything. Your agriculture is going to grow, everything that you need, I'm going to bless you with." And then we read there in verse 10, "And when thou hast eaten and are full," just all I ask is that you bless the Lord God for the good land which He's given you. And for years and years and decades, we've done that in America. We didn't fail to remember verse 10 that I just read. "Then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which thou hast given to us." Thank God for our history, because we acknowledge God and that the good things that God had given to us. Last week we spoke about the four great pillars on which America built this nation. On the foundation of Christianity, we mentioned the home and family, worship, our churches, schools, and our government. All of it honored God at its early beginnings. And because of that, God blessed our businesses. He blessed our military. He blessed our minds. We came up with inventions. He blessed our agriculture. He gave us everything. God blessed everything that America put her hand to do. And all He said was, "Don't forget me. Don't forget me." Number two, prosperity and affluence has the power to produce pride in the hearts of men and women. Verse 11, beware. Notice verse 11 starts out, beware. Now, certainly, what's there to beware, Lord? I mean, you're just giving us everything that we could ever hope and desire for. What in the world should I look out for? Beware, He says, that thou forget not the Lord thy God. Well, how in the world could you do that? How in the world could that be possible? Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping His commandments and His judgments and His statutes which I command thee this day. Verse 13, and when thy herds and thy flocks multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied, such as happened in America, and all that thou heart and all that thou hast is multiplied, and such it has in America, then thy heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God. What's he saying? He's saying there's something inherent about prosperity. It appeals to the sinfulness of man. The sin nature that indwells every individual desires to take credit and receive the glory for all worthwhile accomplishments. That's just something about the sin nature. In other words, the sin nature, simply put, is selfish. And God says, "What? I'm going to heap all this blessing on you." Man, it just didn't get any better than that. However, there's something inherent evil in you that when you are blessed like that, you want to take the glory. Beware. He says that your heart be lifted up. And when that happens, you forget the Lord thy God. Verse 17. And when you forget the Lord thy God, notice verse 17, that thou say in thine heart, my power and the might of my hand hath gotten me this wealth. That, my friend, is directly from the old sin nature. It's selfish. Now, God says, there's just something about it. If you don't keep yourself in check, if America does not keep herself in check, the sin nature and the appeal that prosperity and abundance has to the sin nature will automatically develop pride in our lives, and we take the glory for what we have. It seeks to rob, the sin nature seeks to rob the glory that belongs to God and simply transfers that glory to ourselves. They were even prideful in the wilderness. And when you read in verse 15 through 16, God's talking about how he blessed them even in the wilderness. He says, remember who led thee through the great and terrible wilderness, wherein were fiery serpents and scorpions and droughts, where there was no water, who brought thee forth water out of the rock of flint, who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, which thy fathers knew not. Why? That he might humble thee. Even then, even what little they had, pride came into their life, and they felt like they somehow deserved it. Pride is a terrible, terrible thing, and we're all guilty of it. We have to fight it constantly. You see, the definition of pride is the extreme sense of self-worth. It's taking personal credit for what belongs to God. That's what scares me about our society and our culture that we live in today. It's all about self. And that, the root of that, is pride. We talk about narcissism and narcissistic individual. They're wrapped up in themselves. That, and we can kid about it and laugh about it, but it's selfishness and it's driven by the sin nature. It started with Lucifer in heaven. He was the most beautiful of all the angels, most talented. And it even got, that matter of fact, that's where it all started. There's something about all the glory that God gave Lucifer over other angels and his beauty and his talents. He had a great musical ability and probably a tremendous singer. And after a certain period of time, he began to think about that. And he began to believe, I ought to be above God. And pride immediately was introduced into the world. And pride captured his heart. He says, I will exalt myself above the Most High. I this and I that, and I will do this, and I will ascend to the... It's all I, pride, selfishness. It's the sin nature. And God had to cast him out, along with angels that sided with him. And of course, the battle has been going on ever since. But pride is at the root of all sin. We know the money is, greed is also the root of all evil. But pride is the bottom line, and it's motivated by the satisfaction of self. It says, I'm deserving. I'm the victim. I'm good. I'm worthy. I'm talented. I'm rich. I'm educated. I'm gifted. I'm this and I'm that. Be careful with it. Listen, everything that you and I have was given to us by Almighty God. Amen. We cannot brag about ourselves at all. I mean, if you were born with good looks, then God blessed you. If you were born with certain talents and gifts and the ability to memorize and to go to school and be able to excel, it's given to you by God. Now, I understand it takes hard work to do these things, but I'm simply saying God gifted us everything that you have. And if you'll keep that in mind, that it's not you, it's God, it'll keep you in check. But boy, once you start thinking that, hey, I'm better than you, you're already on the course down, all right? You're already, you're going downward right then, because pride has now slipped into your heart and your mind. And so God says, America, once I've blessed you and you've eaten to the full, this one thing I ask of you, don't forget me. And that's what we're asking our politicians. All we're asking, don't forget the God that brought us here and has blessed America. Why would you do that? And God says, it's going to cost you dearly if you forget me. Verse 18. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant with which he sware unto thy fathers, as it is this day. Number three, pride and forgetfulness can be overcome by returning to the Lord. America, and thank God not all of us, thank God for the Christian who's really serving God, trying to live for God. Now, let me go back for just a minute, because you got to get this. What's the definition of forgetting God? See, we would say, well, I haven't forgotten God. Oh, haven't you? Well, no, I know God. I know Jesus Christ. It'd be like a man being married, and he abandons his family. Just one day he doesn't show up, and this happens quite often. Gets in the car and takes off, and he just disappears. His family's left behind, wife, kids. They have no idea where he's at. He just simply abandoned them. Got tired of living there. Goes to another state, goes all the way across the country, and starts a new life. Now, if you'd walk up to that man 3 years down the road and said, weren't you married to so-and-so? Oh, yeah. Don't you have such and such kids? Oh, well, yeah. He wouldn't think that he has forgotten them. But has he? Absolutely. Absolutely, he has forgotten them. See, forgotten doesn't mean it's not in your mind. And I like the fact that God describes what he means when he says, don't forget me. He actually identifies the terminology. And I like that. And it's found in verse 11. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God. And then he says, oh, by the way, let me define what I'm talking about. In not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes which I command thee this day. What am I saying? I'm saying to you, dear Christian friend, if you call yourself a Christian and you're not keeping the commandments and the statutes and the ordinances of Almighty God, you've forgotten him. Oh, no, I remember Jesus. Oh, yeah. No. See, words have meaning. And God says, I want you to understand how I define forgotten. And to forget me means that you're no longer following me. You're no longer obeying me. And once you stop those things, you have forgotten me. In America, that is an indictment. Christians, it's an indictment. Churches ought to be packed today across America. And the real question is have people forgotten their God? Now, God is telling Israel, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you this land. I'm going to bless everything you touch. And all I want you to do is remember me by, what's he say? Keeping his commandments, his judgments, his statutes, which I command you this day. I want you to do the things I ask you to do. That's all you have to do. And if you'll do those things, I will continue to bless you and give you all kinds of good things. You think, why would you not? The sin nature says, all this prosperity and abundance, I'm beginning to believe that I deserve all of that. And God, you have no right to take it from me whether I follow you or not. All of a sudden, my pride tells me that I am deserving. And to take it away from me, God, you're the bad person, and you're taking it away from me, the good person. That's the way pride plays the game. We transfer the blame to God. God, how in the world could you not bless America again? God says, you've forgotten me. You're no longer keeping my commandments. You don't do the things that I say in the Bible. Matter of fact, you're disregarding almost all the things. You're okay with the sins of this world and our culture. And as it continues to go downhill, you're even happy about it. You've forgotten me. But God says in verse 18, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God. In other words, I want to call you back to remembrance. And how can that be done? America, how can that be done? It's through hearing and reading God's word. It's through confessing that pride has overtaken one's heart. The Bible says this in 1 Peter 5, 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Sometime when you've got time, read the chapter, 2 Chronicles 34. I'll read a couple of verses of it. In 2 Chronicles 34, Manasseh has been ruling, and Amon, his son, have been ruling Jerusalem for 50-some years. They did that which was evil in the sight of God. And they built altars to other gods. They did every vile thing, and the house of God simply lay in ruins as they built their own altars to other gods, and they did evil in the sight of God and caused the people to sin. That's what leadership can do. Beware of ungodly leadership. Josiah was then made king because Manasseh passed away, his son passed away, and Josiah became the king. And he was a godly king. He was a young man. He took the office as a young boy, but he had a love for God from the very beginning. And he began to rebuild the temple, and he had people begin to make the repairs that the evil king had let it all fall apart. And as they were repairing the temple, somebody found an old scroll. It's the Word of God. They hadn't paid any attention to the Word of God for years. It was discarded. There was no place in that culture, in that society, for the Word of God. And somebody brought it to the king, Josiah. Said, we found the Word of God. And he said, well, let's read it. They hadn't heard of it for years. And they begin to read God's blessings and God's warnings. And in 2 Chronicles 34, verse 27, God's speaking to Josiah and says, because thine heart was tender, and thou didst humble thyself before God, when thou heardest his words against this place and against the inhabitants thereof, and humblest thyself before me and didst rend thy clothes and weep before me, I have even heard thee also, saith the Lord, neither shall thine eyes see all the evil that I bring upon this place. And so when Josiah heard that God was going to continue to destroy these people if they continued to forget God and to abandon God, and Josiah immediately put in place procedures to destroy all the altars, the worship to Baal, get rid of anything that was idolatrous. And God says, you humbled yourself before Almighty God, and because that I'm going to bless you, and the evil that I was going to do, I'm not going to do, at least in your lifetime. I'm saying to you, the hope for America is for people to humble themselves before Almighty God, confess their sin, turn back to God. He will bless us again. But anything short of that's not going to work. If we forget God and we neglect to do what he's asked us to do, well, that leads us to the fourth and final point, and that is this. To continually forget the Lord God and his Son Jesus Christ is to invite certain destruction upon your life and the life of your country. Verse 19. It doesn't get any clearer than this. And it shall be. I mean, he's talking, God is saying in certainty, it shall be. If thou do not at all forget the Lord thy God, and walk after other gods, and serve them, and worship them, I testify against you this day, ye shall surely perish. As the nations which the Lord destroyed before your face, so shall ye perish, because ye would not be obedient unto the voice of the Lord your God. God says, if you continue to forget me, and push me out of your country and out of your affairs and out of your laws and out of your daily living, you shall surely perish. Now, you say, well, I just don't believe God. After I understand, God made it very clear. I'm the one that gave you the land. I'm the one who blessed it so that it came forth and prospered plentifully. The same God that gave it to you and blessed it can remove it from you and curse it. And God says, I will do this. The only reason that I blessed it from day one was because you had a heart for me. You built upon the right foundation. You honored me. You gave thanks and you gave glory to God. And God says, I'll keep blessing you. I mean, it is so clear. It is so clear to see the picture. All God says is, I want to be honored because I'm the one who's made it possible. You know, it's like having a rich uncle when you're poor. And rich uncle brings you nice things, Christmas. You always enjoy seeing rich uncle come. Man, is Uncle so-and-so coming this Christmas? Because he brings me nice stuff. And you appreciate rich uncle. You look forward to rich uncle. You give him credit because he's going to bring you nice things. Until you can afford all the nice things that you need. Now you don't need rich uncle anymore. Rich uncle's coming. I don't care. Why? Because you don't need him anymore. What happened? He's still the same uncle. Same relationship. The difference was prosperity. Prosperity produced pride. And now you no longer care about rich uncle because you have more than you need. And now he can't really do anything for you because you do it for yourself. That's exactly what prosperity has done to America. God says, I'm going to give you all these good things. Just don't forget me. But pride says, no, I don't need God anymore. And that's where we're in America. We don't need God anymore. And you know as well as I do, we're sitting here watching America crumble before our very eyes. She's going downhill. Every day you wonder what's going to be next. Whether it's going to be an economic collapse, whether it's going to be a terrorist attack, whether it's going to be an electronic magnetic pulse that's going to wipe out the whole grid as far as electrical grid. It can be anything. Is it going to be some natural disaster? Is it going to be an earthquake? It can be anything. And God has everything at his disposal. If he says, if you don't care for me anymore, if you don't want my protection, if you don't want my blessing, if you don't want what I have to offer, then fine. Try to fix it on your own. And it's hard to believe, but a large majority of people are to the place where we'll fix it ourselves. And we're not fixing it. Only God can fix it. And the only way we're going to get God to fix it is to honor God again. Give him the glory he deserves. God, I'm so sorry. I've abandoned you. I've forgotten you. I don't go to church like I should. God, I'm so ashamed. I don't read my Bible like I should. I'm so ashamed. I don't share my Christian faith with others like I should. I'm so ashamed. Matter of fact, God, I've allowed sin to slip into my life. I'm living like the devil. I'm so ashamed. God would look down and you'd get his attention very quickly. And God say, you know, I like that. Humble yourselves before Almighty God, and he will exalt you. And he says that to a nation. If I could get enough people in that nation to do the same thing, I will bless America again. It all determines what we do with it. Let me just close with these statistics, if I have them here. Brand new book out. This is by George Barna, who is the pollster. Does a lot of Christian polls. He says, America just marked its 239th Independence Day, the birth of what many consider the greatest nation on earth. But after all these years of celebrating, Americans may soon be mourning its downfall. That's the conclusion of researcher George Barna and historian David Barton in their new book, U-Turn, Restoring America to the Strength of Its Roots. They say in there, it says, the founders gave us an amazing foundation. And for us to trample on it or say we're going to build a new one is folly. And let me pause to say this for a second. I was reading the other day, every fundamental movement, I don't care whether it's a church or a country, culture, that turned their back upon God, not one ever returned back to their fundamentalism. In other words, I'm saying to you, once America goes through and we say goodbye to God, it will never, never return to God. It's never happened in the history. Now, there's been great revivals like Nineveh. They didn't know God, and God, somebody, Jonah went there and they accepted God. But after you've known God and you've turned from God, you don't turn back to God. That's tragic. We've got to be very careful. The authors point out that those early Americans were shaped by the Bible and the Judeo-Christian worldview. Today, only 30% of Christians read the Bible. Less than 10% have read it from cover to cover. Notice this, only 9% of born-again Christians have a biblical worldview. 9% of Christians, 9% of Christians have a biblical worldview. In other words, they see the world as God sees the world, as the Bible sees the world. 9%? Barna says only 51% of pastors have a biblical worldview. In other words, they believe what the Bible says. They believe that there's a worldwide flood, that they believe these Jesus did miracles. They believe what the Bible says about the world. Only half of the preachers? They ought to get out of the pulpit. What in the world are they doing standing behind a pulpit preaching the Word of God if they don't believe it? The proportion of unchurched people have risen from 28% to 48% in 6 years. The fastest growing faith group in America are atheists and agnostics. It's America, who has foundation upon the Word of God. I'm saying, and I said it last week, the enemy is in the camp. And they're overthrowing America. They're fighting us and chipping away at the very foundation of our great country and its Christianity. He says, it's making a complete change in values from what was seen 240 years ago. Your order of responsibility back then was to God, country, and family. That's just simply part of biblical thinking that they had. And that's the way they did. They thought their family. They thought God and country. Biblical thinking. That's why the founding fathers were told and specifically taught in school that we have their textbooks. Somebody said, we have their actual textbooks. And if someone comes to you and says you need to run for public office, you're not allowed to say no, he said, because they pointed out your life doesn't belong to you. In other words, they challenged Christians even to get into public office back in those days because it was for the good of America. And as I said earlier, the majority of politicians today wouldn't even qualify for the political office they hold. Thank God there's still time to salvage America. And again, it's just like God told Israel, if you turn back, but if thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, that he may establish his covenant, which he sware unto thy fathers as of this day. We've just got to get back to bringing God back into play in the decisions of our life each and every day. Put God first in your life. I'm going to challenge you every week to do this. Put God first in your life. Do what you know God wants you to do, and we may just have another day. Amen. Stand with me, please.
Welcome to the family. You can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family.
there's always room for more. When I count my blessings, it's easy to see my brothers and sisters that mean so much to me. I think about the many times they've kept me in their prayers, and the countless ways they've always shown me that they care. And I know they'll still walk with me no matter what's ahead. Yeah, so much more than just their words, their lives have always said. Welcome to the family, you can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family, you can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family.